Good morning, everyone, and thank you for starting your day off with me. I'm Jenna Stauffer. I'm excited to do a lot of listening today because my guest this morning is nationally recognized motivational speaker Pat Croce. His name is obviously not a secret down here in the Keys. He's inspired, motivated so many people, not just here, but across our country. Throughout his life, he has accomplished so much, from owning the Philadelphia 76ers to becoming a best-selling author to even starting the world's first authentic pirate museum. One of the things, though, that I'd say I like best about him is that through his speaking engagements, his TV appearances, his businesses, and his books, he is determined to motivate the masses to reach their full potential and realize their dreams. Pat, thank you so much for being
Jenna,
with me
this
morning.
Thank you for that introduction.
No, it was a very easy to do because you have such a long list of accomplishments. And I've been reading a lot about you, Pat, and one of the things that struck out to me right from the beginning was that you got your start delivering newspapers door to door.
That's correct. When I was 16, when I was sixth grade,
okay.
I was 11 years old. I was supposed to be 12. I lied on the little application because I didn't have any money. And so my father put me to work early, and it was delivering papers on a daily route every day, right after school. Go pick up your, I think I had about 55 papers. And then you have to collect the money, and if you did it well, you got tips. So it was all about customer service at a young age. You learned a lot. You learned how to smile to people, how to put their paper in plastic when it was raining. You know, it's funny, I haven't talked about delivering papers forever.
So you've never done it since?
I've delivered a lot of other things since, but not newspapers.
All right, and that was in Philadelphia?
That was outside Philadelphia, correct.
All right, and so after the delivering papers, what was your next step, Pat?
Well, obviously school, and then I went away to college. I went to Westchester University outside Philadelphia first, but it was really just to play football. Mm-hmm. I was a phys ed major, but I knew I didn't want to be a physical education teacher. I got hooked. My mom was a nurse, and I did some volunteer work at a hospital, and I liked this physical therapy. At the time, it's not what it is today. And so I thought, wow, here's physical fitness, and I was always a fitness nut, with medicine. So I went away to University of Pittsburgh and became a physical therapist, and I also got a second degree in athletic training. And it was almost like trainers and physical therapists, sheep herders and wolf tamers. They hated each other. So I had both degrees. Mm-hmm. And then I helped along the time create what you now know as sports medicine.
Mm-hmm. So that was your, that definitely is what you're so well known for. Is
really
is
sports medicine. As a physical therapist back in my earlier life, I helped create first one center, and then two centers, and then three centers, and four centers, up to 40 centers across the country. But it was different. It wasn't where you were in the basement of the hospital because you blew out your knee or hurt your back. We treat the mind as well as the body because you're in pain. So we had to make you believe that what we gave you, your prescription, your exercises, were going to make you feel better. And that's what I've been doing every day, is touching people to make them feel better, whether it's our bar restaurants here in Key West or going out and giving a talk.
Mm-hmm. Now, when did the 76ers come into play?
Oh, that's a good question. I was a physical therapist for the team in 1983-84. Charles Barkley.
I remember
the round,
Charles
round, the rebound. It was my job to get him looking svelte. So I had to get him down from 300 down to 255.
Wow.
And we did. I mean, he wasn't happy camper at the time, but I loved Charles. And that was about 84-85. And so the owner of the team knew me. At the same time, I was a conditioning coach, physical therapist for the Philadelphia Flyers, the hockey team, while I was building my centers. And then about 95, I had a conversation with the owner. Mm-hmm. I'd sold my centers in 93, and it's this old adage, relationships determines results. I had a relationship with the former owner, so he had took a lunch with me.
Mm-hmm.
And when I went to the lunch, I said, sell me 10% of the team. Let me buy some of the team, because the team was awful.
Mm-hmm.
Philadelphia fans were booing him in public. Philadelphia fans aren't the most patient bunch.
Right.
I mean, you either win or you better leave town.
Right.
And so he said, now, Pat, when I sell, it's going to be all or nothing. So I went and got a partner, Comcast. Mm-hmm. They became my partner in this. And so it took a while, half a year, to marinate this stew that became an ownership. And I only owned a small piece, but I wanted to run them.
You wanted to run it.
And so the next 5 years, it took it from worst to first on a glorious, fabulous journey, where we lost in the finals in 2001 to Shaq and Kobe. I hate Shaq.
Well, we're going to talk more about this. We're going to take a quick break right now, but don't go away because I'll be back with you right after these messages. Stay with us. Another thing we all know Pat Croce for is his time with the Philadelphia 76ers. Now, when he took over the team, they were actually last place in the league, but he had the magic touch and ended up having one of the greatest turnaround stories in NBA history. Pat, before we went to break, you were saying how you can't stand Kobe and Shaq, right?
Kiddingly, although I do know them both, and they're both great guys, but not when you're competing against them. Mm-hmm. And that was in the finals of 2001. We won the first game. Allen Iverson, who was my first-round draft pick when I first took over the team, was fabulous. He didn't belong in that court against these guys, because it was like David versus Goliath. But then they took us the next four, and it was just a fabulous run. But I should tell you, Jenna, like any successful business or endeavor, it's the people that surround you. I can't play basketball, but I had Allen Iverson when I was lucky enough to win that lottery in 1996. Larry Brown, great coach. And then the pieces, like any team, on or off the court, and just letting them, providing an environment for excellence. And that was my goal. Motivate him, keeping him, you know, chastise him. When Allen missed practice, I was the one that had to sit him out. The coach wouldn't touch him. I'm the one that had to make him stay home, because the press is going to be all over you. But you had to, right? You have to discipline. You have to congratulate. Like anything in everyday life, you want to pat him on the back or kick him in the butt.
So you wanted to kick him in the butt.
Oh, many times. I wanted to pat him on the back during that run for the finals.
Okay. Now, when you took over the team, Pat, you were saying that you had to keep going back to the guy. He didn't want to give you the team at first.
No, like anything else, nothing's ever easy, Jenna. Mm-hmm. When I first told him that, sell the team to me, no. But he didn't, well, he said, not yet. When I want to sell, I'll sell, I don't want to sell yet. And all I heard was yet. I didn't hear no. And when I hear no, the salesperson in me interprets it as no, not yet. And I just keep coming back and coming back. And I really paralyzed his resistance with my persistence. And I believe that anyone who's taking action on their passion, and your viewing audience, should continue to go after it. And if you get a no or a negative, find out, I must not have asked the right question. Do more homework and get more due diligence and more insight, more evidence, and go back again and again and again. Just like you're here. You didn't just knock on a door and they said, okay, Jenny, you can have a show. No, people get rejections, but most people, they cry and they walk away and they think, oh, my goals and dreams are not going to happen. No, pick it up, learn, and go at it again.
I love that attitude, and it is so, so true. How many times did you go back to him, Pat?
Well, I can only tell you this, that in the press conference, when it announced it on April 19th, 1996, the media says, Harold, why'd you finally decide to sell the team? He looked down the dais and pointed to me and said, because Pat Croce called me 50 times. So 49 times he said no.
But that 50 time, he got it. And now, didn't people say you were crazy, too, for taking over a team that was in the last place?
No, they why? Why would you want to do that? The team always sucked. Mm-hmm. They weren't even good. They didn't even sell out when Dr. J was in the championship round in 83. I said, whoa, stop. Why? Because if you infuse energy and team esprit, and you get everyone involved in your dream, and you communicate in such a way that they feel part of ownership of your, special things can happen. Mm-hmm. We only had less than 4,000 season ticket holders when I took over the team in 96. By 2001, there was 40,000 waiting to buy a ticket. No, forget about it. It was fabulous.
You ignited the passion.
Yes, I did, because I was passionate about this. Mm-hmm. See, I can only do what I'm passionate about. I'm passionate about Key West, and that's why I developed the Rum Barrel, Island Dogs Bar, Green Parrot, Charlie Mack's. These are institutions down in Key West here that I'm passionate about, making great memories for people who come to Key West, so that when they leave, they say, wow, we had a fabulous time. We did Fury and Water Sports, and we went to Island Dogs and had this great key lime martini. Mm-hmm. You want to attack people, right? You want to attack them in a way where it touch on their emotions. Mm-hmm. So it makes memories.
You do that. You definitely do that. Now, how did you get to Key West? And you were doing the 76ers up in Philadelphia. Where in the world did Key West come into play?
Oh, that's a great question, Jen. It was about 25 years ago. I brought my son down there. I took my daughter. I had to do something for Disney, a video out in Anaheim. And so I took her with me. She was 10 years old at the time. Mm-hmm. It was with Sport Goofy. I was really into fitness at the time. And so I promised my 8-year-old son, Michael, we would do something. He wanted to go skiing. I never skied. I never had any money during the wintertime. And then once I started making it, I had Flyers and Sixers and then sports medicine centers. So we were going to go skiing, but it was raining in the Pocono Mountains. So I said, let's go to Key West, because I was always fascinated with Jimmy Buffett. I loved his music, even 25 years ago. Mm-hmm. So we came down with a buddy of mine, Joe Masters, who had been here before, and damn if we didn't see Jimmy Buffett and get a picture with him. But that, I fell in love with the eccentricity and the eclectic group of people and the water and the, it's just such a fun place. Mm-hmm. I've been coming ever since, and then about 12 years ago, I bought a home down here.
Okay. So it was that trip.
Yes.
That was supposed to be a ski trip.
Yeah, how about that? Well yeah. said.
That sold you on Key West.
That's right.
When did the first business come about, Pat?
In Key West?
Mm-hmm.
I started the Pirate Museum here. It's mm-hmm. called Pirate Soul. And again, Jenna, this was poor due diligence on my part. I used more prejudicial evidence. I loved Key West, and I thought a Pirate Museum in Key West where I have a home would be fabulous. But it was wrong, because people come here for the water activities. They come here for the bars and the partying and the camaraderie. If rainy day, they might come in the museum, so that's why I moved the entire museum to St. Augustine, where it's doing fabulous, because Heritage Tourism works there.
Mm-hmm.
Here, it's the, and so next door to it, there was the rum, there was a bar there. It was ugly, so I renovated and built the Rum Barrel. Oh. And then across the street, Dave Thibault, myself, and my son, we bought the Island Dogs Bar.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
so then we went, I was lucky enough to do with John Vagnoni, the Green Parrot, and keep that tradition going. Mm-hmm. And then next door, Charlie Max.
Mm-hmm. And these are all fabulous restaurants and bars that you have just mentioned. We're going to take a quick break right now, but I'm going to have you talk more about your fascination with pirates when we return
Super.
From these messages. Stay with us. Welcome back. Pat, one thing that I've been noticing while I've been sitting here with you is pirate tattoos.
Oh, yes, I love pirates. I have always loved pirates.
I was just going to say, when did this fascination with pirates begin?
I was a youngster. It was third, fourth grade. Watched Errol Flynn in Captain Blood. It's an old movie. I remember sitting on the living room floor, and I just loved that swashbuckling and going after the gold. And from that day on, you know, I just fell in love. And I used to carve in skull and crossbones on my arm with a knife. I would paint skull and crossbone on my shirt. The nuns would whack me for having a skull and crossbone on. But I just always, and so I, when I start making some money, my first artifact, Jenna, was a 1684 first edition book by Esquemelin called Buccaneers of America. And when you first open it up, the first plate shows you Captain Morgan. I thought, yeah, and that was the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Now I have well over 800 artifacts in the Pirate Museum in St. Augustine, some of which have been loaned to me by the state of Florida.
Mm-hmm.
The Secretary of State opened up the vaults in the Capitol and allowed me to get the gold doubloons and pieces of bait. Just to be able to touch history is amazing.
You were in heaven. When
like a kid in a candy store.
Now wait, what's this about a jolly flag? Or
a Jolly Roger.
Roger,
the skull
flag.
And crossbone
mm-hmm.
is called the Jolly Roger. A pirate would shoot a shot across the bow of a prey, of mm-hmm. a merchant ship, and then would hoist the black flag and then start vapor banging their cutlasses against the gunwales. And that would scare the bejesus out of the prey, and they would just strike their flag and give up all the booty. But it was this flag, it was more like psychological warfare back in the time, and there's only two flags remaining mm-hmm. in existence, and one of them I had.
That's awesome. That's
it's
awesome.
In the museum. It's really cool. And it, when I first got it, it took me, again, over 10 years to get this, because mm-hmm. certain collectors have it.
Mm-hmm.
I touched it, and it kind of melted in my hand. I thought, oh, so I brought it to the University of Pennsylvania, and over a year it took before they cured it and made sure that it didn't disintegrate.
Mm-hmm. Now, St. Augustine is where your museum is
yes.
located right now. How's the response to people who visit the museum, Pat?
You can check on TripAdvisor. We've only been open, it'll be 2 years. 2 years right now!
Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact,
congratulations!
I think
it was yesterday or today. Yeah, thank you. It's been fabulous, fabulous. Over 100,000 people come in a year. And it's really great because people think, oh, it's going to be pirates, it's going to be Johnny Depp. And no, although Johnny Depp's sword is in there, no. It's mostly the first 8 exhibition areas. We take you back 300 years because all the artifacts are 200 and 300 years old. And the response has been phenomenal. Everything I had hoped it would be.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really been. And so, but I'm not stopping because just last year I led a maritime expedition to Portobello, Panama in search of Sir Francis Drake. Mm-hmm. The greatest pirate of all times. I know we call him a knight, but he was a pirate.
Mm-hmm.
And his scuttled ships. So we have some of that in a new exhibit.
It's so fascinating. And would you say that your fascination with pirates even escalated since moving to the Keys?
Oh, without a doubt, Jenna. Mm-hmm. Yes, mm-hmm. it has escalated because pirate ships were right around here.
Mm-hmm.
I had the opportunity with Sean Fisher, whose grandfather found the Etosha, to dive on the Etosha. Those gold doubloons and silver pieces of eight, we found two of them that day. That's what pirates were after. These are 400 years old. I mean, it's and our waters surrounding the Keys, it's just a wonderful experience. And we all want to be a pirate at heart.
I think you're right about that, right?
You know, no laws, no bosses, no rules. And pirates weren't all bad. They had democracy on ship. They voted the captain in because they hated autocratic society. And remember, in England, if you were born in a certain class, you were stuck there. If you were lower class, you were always lower class. But in a pirate ship, a slave, a lower class seaman could become a captain.
Now, earlier, well, right there, it's a photo of your grandsons, Pat, right behind us right now. Do they have this fascination with pirates?
Oh, my goodness, and that's Charlie and Mac. Believe it or not, that's how I named Charlie Mac's next to the Green Parrot. But yeah, everyone thinks pirates, they think the skull and crossbones are family heirloom. They all love pirates. You kidding me? Even my granddaughters, I have 6 grandchildren right now. How cool is that?
So cool.
So yeah, they all love pirates. I mean, and my wife buys them skull and crossbone stuff. So whether it's their pajamas, their bathing suits, their rain gear, and they love the Keys. As a matter of fact, Charlie's a Bubba. He was born in Key West.
Oh,
how cool is that?
And now he's got a restaurant named
after
him. Now, Pat, you have the museum in St. Augustine. Any plans to bring a museum in other places throughout the country?
No, it's hard, Jenna, because the pieces are only one of a kind. It's not like Ripley's where you can replicate something.
Right.
And I don't want to dilute the effect, because when you walk through those 9 exhibition areas, I want the whole full Monty. I want you really being emotionally immersed in this atmosphere. It's not walking through like the Smithsonian. Although it's been claimed it's like the Smithsonian meets Disney, I want you feeling like, you just get that whole, how cool is this? Because you can touch, there's about 2 dozen interactives. I mean, we have real cannons where I had Disney Imagineers touch it. So when you touch the light hole with a fiber optic, it fires, the floor's shaking, and you're thinking, oh my, I mean, you see young and old. Give me that. Let me try that.
Well, we're going to show a video right now, Pat, of you talking a little bit more about the museum in St. Augustine. I enjoyed watching the video, and I know our viewers will.
Oh, cool.
So enjoy.
I was just a kid when I first saw Earl Flynn in the movie Captain Blood, fighting his way from slavery into a swashbuckling life of piracy. I was so intrigued by the pirate's freedom from tyranny and authority that I start carving skull and crossbones into my ruler and onto my notebooks at school. Well, needless to say, the nuns didn't like that very much, and they beat me with that ruler. Well, years later, I really had the opportunity to indulge in my passion for pirates, and I bought my first real pirate artifact. A 300-year-old first edition book called Buccaneers of America by Alexander Esquemelin. I opened that baby up and I dove inside, and I was hooked. Sometimes people ask me if I'm a pirate, and I say yes, but 300 years too late. Over the past 30 years, I've studied the lives of pirates. I've gone on international maritime adventures to recover their booty, and I've collected more than 500 of their rare scattered relics. You can see them all at my St. Augustine Pirate and Treasure Museum in St. Augustine, Florida. Like the world's only pirate treasure chest and one of only 2 Jolly Roger flags in existence, and I'm still collecting. Researching and writing about pirates is in my bones. That's the bloody reason why I wrote the Pirate Handbook, with the true-to-life secrets of how to be a pirate and live to tell the tale. You pick this baby up and you'll be ready to cut some throats. You can call it the ultimate gangway to a life of danger, intrigue, daring, and fortune. Me, I call it a lifestyle, and I'm living it. The question is, will you?
Pat, your newest restaurant to open up here in Key West is Charlie Mac's. You mentioned that's named after your grandsons. Great idea. Tell us a little bit more about the restaurant.
Well, I own the Green Parrot with John Vagnoni, who's been here 35 years. He's the soul of the parrot, the music at Presario. And next door, the building was Bubba Lou's. Before that, it was the Meteor, and I love the old Meteor. And it was up for sale, and no one was buying it, so I took it, renovated for the past 6 months, and then but I needed something different, a value proposition, and there's no really great smokehouse in Old Town for pulled pork and barbecue ribs and all that good stuff, you know, getting yourself all dirty. So I brought down a gold medalist from South Carolina, Beauregard Hammond, and he trained the staff, and I sent our chef up to his restaurants in South Carolina, and so bang, and you know, you were there, thank goodness, for it just opened in October, so we're expecting all of the Keys to come on down and get sloppy.
Yeah, it is delicious. I can attest to that, because I have been there, I have tried the food, and I love it, so good job.
Thank you.
Now, Pat, what is on the horizon for you now?
Well, if you promise not to tell anyone.
I'll try not to. No, I promise.
Tomorrow I have the opportunity, the Green Parrot's an iconic bar in Key West, the opportunity to buy Half Shell and Turtle Crow's, two other iconic seafood bars on the waterfront, is coming to be, and I'm going to Settlement next week.
Wonderful.
So yeah, I'm really, really excited. The atmosphere, and I really, like the Sixers, I want to dust them off and bring them back to prominence, because Turtle Crow's was the first bar I went to 25 years ago with my
really?
Wife.
Really?
Yeah,
okay.
So I went, and Half Shell, what can you say?
Yeah, two great bars.
Totally.
So you, I know that you will turn these bars around, though, even more. Are you going to bring a little pirate taste?
No, not at all. No, I don't want anyone stealing anything either in my bar. No, because you don't, I never want anything corny. In Key West, the things that only work are legitimately really cool, funky. Mm-hmm. What I will bring is the funk. We'll bring the funk back.
You will do that. Pat, are you here in Key West? I mean, do you want to spend the rest of your life here in Key West, would you say?
Oh, I'll always spend at least a week to 2 weeks every month for the rest of my life here. Now, I love this island. I mean, I just love the people of the island. I love being on my bicycle. I'm dressed for you. I put a collared shirt on. But I got shorts up here. I mean, I rarely wear a tank top, shorts, and flip-flops, it's fabulous, and that's me. So, and no one has to have any false pretenses here. You don't have to keep up with the Joneses here. Everyone's friendly, you know, and you got to keep an eye over your back because some pirates do live on this island.
Very, very true. Pat, our book covers, your book covers are behind us right now, I should say. People can still pick up these copies on Amazon, right?
Yeah, you can go to Amazon or patcroce.com because, yeah, they're still for sale, probably not in bookstores now, but through Amazon. And my latest one, which was the Pirate Handbook, came out last year, and it's pretty cool because if you found it on the street and you picked it up, it would teach you how to really be a pirate. So it's way cool.
Oh, you
can learn. As a matter of fact, Hollywood's looking at making it an option for a movie, almost like The Goonies.
I hope that they do that.
Me too.
No one knows more about pirates than this guy. Well. And now, Pat, I'm putting you on the spot real quick. I thank you so much for being here with me this morning. Do you have some motivation mojo for our viewers this morning?
Okay, let me see, but I truly believe, I really believe this, that if you take action on your passion with a focused determination and an expectation of success, not wanting success, but expecting it, the world will create circumstances for the fulfillment of your dreams and goals. But you have to go at it with something you're passionate about, not just the almighty dollar, something you really want to do, and then be positive about. Don't leave a back door and say, well, in case I don't make it. No, an expectation of success, a focused determination, dreams do come true.
Wonderful. What a great way to end the show this morning. Again, thank you for being here with
me today. My pleasure. Thanks, Jenna. You were great.
You were great. And thank you, everybody, for tuning in this morning and joining me. I hope you can join me again tomorrow at 7 a.m. and back at 8:30 a.m. Take care and have a great rest of your day.